Being born in Africa puts you at a disadvantage when it comes to many different things, and football is no exception. I can only imagine the number of talented players who went under the radar because they were simply too far off sight to get the chance they deserved. But many have risen above all odds and proven themselves at the highest level. From two-time treble winner Samuel Eto'o to two-time Premier League top scorer Didier Drogba. But if there was one African player who proved that nothing was impossible, it was George Weah. And today, I'm not only going to tell you how he rose above all to become one of European football's most dominant figures in the late 90s, but also how he managed to become the only player to win the Ballon d'Or while representing an African country at the international level. But before I get into all that, I would just like to ask you one thing, and that is to quickly like the video if you enjoy this series, and of course, if you're new, to subscribe. There's one video just like this one coming out every week, and yeah, let's get into it. George Weah was born in Liberia in 1966, and before he even managed to say his first words, his parents would get a divorce, sending him and his three brothers to be raised by their grandmother, who was already in charge of raising another 9 children. From then on, it seems he did the best he could to live a normal life, trying to stay in school and complete his studies, but in the last year of high school, he ended up dropping out. Though I couldn't find a reason as to why he dropped out, it isn't too hard to assume why. Ever since he turned 15, George had started playing football for a local youth team, quickly moving up the ranks, and in 1986, he would take the jump into senior football, playing for a while at mighty Barol, scoring 7 goals in 10 games as they would go want to win the Liberian Premier League. Amongst these incredible first few years, before his first rise in notoriety, he would actually still work a normal job as a switchboard technician for a telecom company. Regardless, in his second season, he would move to the Invincible 11, where he would play even better, getting 24 goals in 23 matches and once again winning the Liberian Premier League. If you're wondering how these two teams rank amongst other Liberian teams, they actually seem to be the joint most successful ever, having won their Premier League 13 times each. After this domestic success, Weah surely could not imagine how fast his life would change from there on. First, he would move to Cameroon to play for Tonnerre Yaoundé, where, of course, once again he would manage an incredible tally of 14 goals in 18 matches, and that's where the domino chain starts. At the time, the Cameroon national team coach was Claude Leroy, who, as the name might suggest, is French, and of course, since all French people know each other, he would go and tell Arsène Wenger, who coached Monaco at the time, about this incredible young man he had watched play, which would lead Wenger to be curious enough to fork out an incredible amount of... Well, I've tried to make sure I got the value right, but it seems there are conflicting reports, but given that I've seen some as low as £12,000, you can probably see how Wenger wasn't too worried about making this bet. To make a quick comparison, the previous year, Ruud Gullit was transferred for £6 million, which is about 500 times more than that. So yeah, at this point, Weah was off to Europe, finally getting the shot that many can only ever wish for. As he joined AS Monaco, he would get the chance to play alongside some relatively big names like Glenn Hoddle and Matt Hatley. In his first season though, he did not manage to win any trophies, getting the closest as he lost the final of the French Cup to Marseille. He did manage to win an award I'm sure meant a lot to him, considering that he was just getting started, the African Player of the Year. From then on out, it was a steady climb to the top, but his last two seasons with Monaco would be the defining moments of his time there, as he won his only trophy with the club, the French Cup, and got close to achieving the unbelievable, as in his last season, he would score the opener against Feyenoord as Monaco made it to the Cup Winners' Cup final. But unfortunately, once there, they would not be able to make the most out of the moment, losing 2-0 to Werder Bremen. Before he left France, there was still time for a 3-season run at PSG. This time Weah was transferred for €6.5 million, completely dwarfing his first transfer. At PSG, he would be far more successful trophy-wise. taking home a total of 4, including most importantly the league title in 1994. But above all, he got the top level experience that he just hadn't gotten so far. After making it to the semi-finals of both the UEFA Cup and the Cup Winners' Cup in his final season with PSG, he would repeat the same feat, but this time in the Champions League. That year's tournament would in a way be responsible for bringing him to the spotlight where everyone could see just how great he was. He had an incredible group stage, scoring in both matches against Dynamo Kiev, as well as both matches against Bayern Munich, with one of the goals being an exceptional solo effort that would have been enough to get a lot of people questioning themselves about this player's worth. Had only he also managed to score in his first match against Spartak Moscow, he would have become the first player ever to score in all matches of the Champions League group stage. Unfortunately, this goal-scoring form did not translate into the knockout stage as much, though he did get PSG's only goal at the Camp Nou. As his European dream came to an end, perhaps he realized that this wouldn't be his best chance, as offers kept coming from many of Europe's greats, and eventually AC Milan would be the ones to get this rising star, as Weah finally got to play with some truly world-class names, from Roberto Baggio to Paolo Maldini, Baresi, Costa Curta, Desailly, Patrick Vieira and Paulo Futre. Honestly, once he was there, it couldn't have started any better. 5 goals in his first 5 matches, and it looked like Weah and Baggio would dominate Italy together for the years to come, and perhaps this dream was enough to get the world of football excited for what was to come, as by the end of the year, Weah would win the Ballon d'Or. The dream would keep going at full speed for the remainder of the season, as Weah not only managed to win the Serie A, but to at the same time be the club's leading goal scorer despite only managing a relatively modest 15 goals that season. The first half of the following season would be, to say the least, oddly eventful. Either be it for the incredible goal-scoring form he displayed, getting 11 goals in 10 matches, or for, well, AC Milan met FC Porto for the Champions League in the group stage, and to man Mark Weah, Porto had Jorge Costa. He was the club captain at the time, and if there's one thing to mention about Porto as a club or Jorge Costa as a player, it is that their whole philosophy revolved around the willpower to give it all on the pitch and to be as brave as one can be, or as the Portuguese beautifully put it in one single word, garra. If any Porto player ever had garra, it was Jorge Costa. It was exceptionally... how can I say this nicely? Well, I really can't. He was aggressive. He was the type of defender who would not hesitate to break your legs if it meant seeing his club winning a major title. And as you might imagine, after 2 matches of constant back and forth with him, Weah had enough. And as they made their way to the tunnel at the end of the match, he walked towards Costa, said a few nasty words to him, and though not much is known about what happened there, it ended with a bloody Jorge Costa explaining in a press conference that Jorge Weah had just broken his nose with a headbutt. As you might imagine, UEFA did not take this too kindly and ended up suspending him for 6 games. So, this is all kind of funny and interesting, but there's one side I left out, so we could now focus on it. After this whole incident, Weah told the press that he did it because Jorge Costa had abused him throughout the whole match with racist remarks. Of course, there is no way to ignore just how dreadful something like this is and how it should have no space in football or anywhere else for that matter. But as touchy as the subject is, I feel like I would be doing you a disservice by not mentioning another thing. There were 0 witnesses to confirm any of this, despite the extremely packed tunnel with dozens of people claiming to have watched it all happen. So much so that Jorge Costa sued Weah for defamation, claiming to feel extremely misjudged since he did not consider himself capable of such acts. And to add to all this mess, Weah would eventually attempt to apologize to Costa, only for him to refuse his apology since he could not forgive him for what he once again claimed to be false accusations. Well, it's a tough situation, but also very interesting. I just wanted to make sure you guys got to hear all about it, so... moving on, the following seasons would be disastrous with Milan, somehow going as low as an 11th place finish in the league, but eventually as Capello left and was replaced by Zaccheroni, the team would immediately climb back to the top and win another Serie A. Regardless, at this point Weah was 33 years old and was showing signs of his age, leading to him being loaned out for half a season to Chelsea. At his new club, he quickly became a fan favorite, scoring the winner against Tottenham in his Premier League debut. Despite this, over the rest of the season he would only manage 4 more goals, and even as he was a considerable reason as to how Chelsea managed to win the FA Cup that year, it would eventually be deemed unnecessary by the club, and since there was no need for him at Milan either, he would end up joining another Premier League team who, funnily enough, at least from today's perspective, were a newly promoted side at the time. That club was Manchester City. Yeah. It would only last 2 months there, as he very justifiably felt offended by how frequently he was getting benched, an odd approach to have towards the next Ballon d'Or winner who just decided to join your newly promoted squad, but, well, to each its own. If I might add, it was probably a good decision to leave Man City, as they would get relegated right back to where they came from that season. But as I was saying, he left and went back to France, joining Marseille, where he spent a single season before joining Al Jazeera in the United Arab Emirates, as he would finally put an end to his career in 2003. There are two things I'd like to point out about his career. First of all, it's very easy to dismiss him based on the fact that he wasn't the most prolific of strikers at all, averaging slightly less than a goal every 2 matches throughout his career, but Weah was in a way the prototype of the modern striker. He operated mainly outside the box, being exceptional at quite simply dragging the defense towards him to open spaces so other players could score. He was mainly praised for his stamina, his pace, technical ability and impressive physique. My point is, he didn't have to score 50 goals a season because he quite simply did much more besides goal scoring. Secondly, I'd also like to point out a really heartwarming thing I read about him and to explain why I didn't mention his international career so far. Well, he never played the World Cup. He is one of the best players to never set foot in football's most loved competition, but there would be nothing more he could have done to help underdogs Liberia. He put his heart and soul into helping his country achieve the most in football terms, putting money from his own pockets into kits, all other kinds of supplies, travel, and even bonuses if the players managed to win. And honestly, in a way, it worked. They managed to qualify to the African Cup of Nations twice, and at a point they almost made it to the World Cup, though not quite. As I said, I read a quote from a paper from back in 2000 saying he did all for the squad and was loved by his people because of it so much so that they even claimed they would like him to be president one day. And guess what? As hard as it might be to believe, he is the current president of Liberia. His life has been one hell of a ride, that's for sure. And on a funny last note, how many times do you think George Costa has made jokes about getting his nose broken by the president of Liberia? Forgive the awful pun, but that's one hell of a punchline. I digress. So, getting into the ranking system. First of all, I'd like to mention this is a tough one. The ranking system was built to try and make sure that I'd rank players fairly, but sometimes it just doesn't work as well as I'd hoped to. And I'm sure this will be one of those times, so bear with me. First, finishing. He produced some incredible strikes, but being way less prolific than some of his peers, he can't get a perfect score. It's a 9 out of 10. Secondly, positioning. I think this was the main culprit when it came to his underwhelming goals tally. He sacrificed this part of his game so he could be more involved in a build-up. Still, there is value to be seen there, so it's an 8 out of 10. Speed and physicality is easy, a 10 out of 10. The man was incredible. When it comes to first touch and ball control, he clearly deserves a high score, but I feel like his dribbling relied more on his speed at times than his ball control, so it's a 9 out of 10. Mentality is another 9 out of 10. He clearly loved the sport and was willing to do everything to achieve his dream, but I feel like once at the top he could have been a little more passionate. It seems he wasn't hungry for more once he reached world-class status. Longevity and adaptability is a 7 out of 10. If you look at it, he had a very short peak. By the time he won the Ballon d'Or and moved to AC Milan, he was already 30 years old, so I guess there wasn't much he could have done. Flair is a 9 out of 10. He was just stupendous to watch. Skillful, strong, fast, and capable of some outrageous strikes. What more could you ask for? Now, the one attribute that's gonna ruin his score, the trophy cabinets. He never played a World Cup and never won an international tournament. As sad as it might be, it's a 5 out of 10. Finally, the icon factor. In Europe, he's been very forgotten, but I'm sure in Africa he has to be very valued. Considering how much he achieved, it's a 7 out of 10. This totals out to 73 out of 90, which honestly is a low score, and I feel like he deserved a bit more, but I'd feel biased if I made an extra effort to give him an higher score. But remember, nothing is lost, you can still use the link in the description to vote for his X Factor, which could improve his score substantially, so yeah, go ahead. On this note, I'd like to show you that I've added Francesco Totti's X Factor score to the table. You voted him in the legendary category, which leads to him being paired with Buffon and Rivaldo. And yeah, that's it. I hope you enjoyed. This was George Weah's career in a video. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And I'd also like to say that I'm sorry. I feel like this video is kind of very low energy. I just feel kind of tired with exams and everything in college. It's just really taking a toll on me. But yeah, regardless, this is it. And yeah, see you next time. Bye.